Marvin Gaye, the late Marvin Gaye, the great Marvin Gaye, with one of his signature songs, Inner City Blues, the title track of his 1971 album. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid. And we're going to talk a bit about the Inner City Blues today. We'll talk about the summary execution of Ahmaud Arbery. He would have celebrated his 26th birthday over the weekend. Instead, thousands turned out all over the country, and particularly in his hometown, his home state, I should say, of Georgia, to mark his death day. Not his birthday, but his death day, which was February 23rd. Vowing that his white vigilante killers be brought to justice. Arbery was shot and killed by a father and son vigilante team who justified killing him, saying he looked like someone who had been burglarizing homes in the neighborhood. And when they ordered him to stop so they could question him the way law enforcement officers would question a suspect, Arbery ran away from them. Arbery's mother, Wanda Cooper Jones, said her former high school footballer son jogged around the neighborhood all the time to keep fit. In fact, he was jogging at the time that his path crossed that of these vigilantes. And they were riding in a white pickup truck. And it was clear that he was targeted by them. He was trying to get away. A video shows the armed men confronting Arbery and Arbery trying to get away from them. Three shots were fired at close range, the video showed, and Arbery, fatally wounded, collapsed and fell to the ground. Not until mass mobilization by the community and the involvement of several high-profile lawyers and civil rights activists did the state and federal law enforcement authorities move, however slowly, on the case. We're going to ask today the question, will there be justice? And by justice, we mean an indictment, you know, the things that constitute justice in circumstances like these. An indictment, a trial, a conviction, and prison for Ahmaud's killers? That's the question we're dealing with today. Since the weekend protests, there's been a development, and that is that the state authorities have now petitioned the federal government, the federal law enforcement authorities, to come in and help with this case. And that's a glaring sign that there is a collusion going on between both state and federal authorities, that this case is really so hot, it's not to be touched for all kinds of reasons. We'll get into that today. But we should start where they ended over the weekend, with this suggestion or this petition to the federal government to send the feds in to take over this case. It's the top reason that all of the people at the local level in the state, in law enforcement, who are handling this case, they should be fired, all of them. And for the simple reason that petitioning the feds to come in, even before they took a good crack at the case, is tantamount to admission that they can't handle it or won't handle it. So since they can't or won't handle the case, since it's too complex for them to do, to handle, get them out. All of them. Clean house. And make it very clear that this is not, as tragic as it is, it is not a difficult case. It is not so complex as to be unsolvable and unprosecutable. And that is why the state apparatus should have taken care of its share of the business. But before you even give it a try to raise the specter that it is such a big case, so overwhelming, so daunting, the local folks can't handle it, then we should take their word and believe they can't handle it and get them out. I've covered a lot of cases involving racially tinged matters, including murders. And I can't understand why the feds have not yet said, why are you knocking on our door this soon? You have all you need to get this case done. You have the laws which are written and very clear. The statutes are there that spell out in great detail how you charge a person with a particular kind of crime. You have enough personnel to get it done, to do a thorough investigation. And the first thing you can do is say, we give up. We don't have the wherewithal to try this case. It is so complex. It is just so overwhelming. We just can't see our way through it. So we are not going to attempt to even assemble the case. We know from the beginning, even before we even lift a finger to prosecute this case, we know even now that it cannot be done. And the feds are actually entertaining the idea of taking over this case, which I think is absolutely the wrong thing to do. They should not be permitted to do that. Let us get a clear understanding that the local or state apparatus is unable to do its job. It admits it cannot do its job, even with all of the resources allocated to it so that it can do its job. It's got courtrooms. It's got methods to put together a jury. It's got defendants. It's got a victim. It's got all the pieces of the puzzle. And still the state is being allowed to pose this non-item that it can't prosecute its case. It would prefer, for all kinds of reasons, to defer to the federal government, to the higher authority, when it's so clear. You have all the facts available to you so far, and they tell a story, a very clear story. You have a victim who is black. You have a vigilante father and son team, white. You have established that a crime occurred. In fact, it was filmed. It was somebody with a camera got it all, including when the shots were fired and when he fell to the ground. You have everything you need to walk into a courtroom and begin your trial. That's my first question. Why is it acceptable? And somebody has to explain it in detail. Why is it acceptable that the feds are being called in? This case is, it's a terrible case, sure. But it is a case that can be tried. And if you're saying you cannot try this case, then you shouldn't be able to try any case. You have evidence. You have videotape. You have eyewitnesses. You have all the elements that are necessary to put a case together and bring it to the court. Put it before a jury. So it seems to me, before we even get to whether the feds are going to handle it or not, the first question that must be resolved is this state saying, in so many words, we can't do our job, we're not qualified. We can't handle this case. Then you have no right to exist as a law enforcement body, as part of the law enforcement body of the state. You should be disbanded and thrown out. I have no idea why they're getting away with this. And people are saying, well, they're actually looking at this as a good thing. The feds are going to come in and take over the case. This is what they want. So they don't have this to deal with at the state level. Give it to the feds. Let them handle it. We are out of it. Well, of course, we haven't heard definitively that the federal government is going to take over this case. I am saying point blank, they shouldn't and they must not. The state has everything it needs to try this case, and therefore it must be tried. Now, there's a little hitch here. One of the pursuers was a law enforcement officer. So they're hiding behind the idea that they are so interested in impartiality. They don't want any question about whether the state, if it tried the case, would be facilitating the rationale that the state itself committed a conflict of interest by trying a case in which a former police officer was involved. This happens all the time, all over the United States. Cops kill civilians and they are put on trial. So, no matter how they twist it and turn it, I think the local people in the state should insist, put the state on notice. You're not going to shirk your responsibility here. And it's going to be in the open. We'll see how you deal with such a case. All the elements are there. You have a young black man. You have two white men, father and son, chasing him down in a pickup truck, because they thought he looked like one of the burglars or one of the ne'er-do-wells that they had seen in the neighborhood, and they chase him down and corner him. And he was moving pretty fast. He's a jogger. His mother verified that as a football player in high school, this is how he kept in shape, jogging. So they, even in a truck, they had to speed up to catch up to him. So it was intentional. This was not an accidental thing. They pursued him. They chased him down. They had two shotguns and a pistol. And they had no affiliation with any branch of the law. And in no time at all, you hear the shots ring out. You see him falling to the ground, fatally wounded. So that is item number one. I have always maintained that the feds themselves have made it so easy to give local law enforcement people and agencies a big break. People psychologically think that, well, if the feds are in, then it is at least a signal that things would go right. Absolutely wrong. Absolutely wrong. There is no guarantee you get justice when the feds are involved. And in this case, as I said, one of the two men chasing this young man down was himself a law enforcement investigator. Clear-cut conflict of interest. So we have to know why the state law enforcement apparatus found it explainable and the right thing to do to yield their jurisdiction in the first place. Oh, we can't handle the case. Well, why? They haven't spelled out why. We see people are in the streets. We see the coverage encouraging more and more people to get involved, and they're irritated because this is a pattern the African American and Latino communities have gone through for decades. It hasn't stopped. They've found every kind of excuse as to why justice will not prevail. And they use all kinds of methods to divert attention and to make people believe they take the case so seriously, they realize they are falling short on the skills to prosecute such a case. And all of that, in my view, is hogwash. If the local state authorities cannot or believe they cannot prosecute this case, lest people say that they are accommodating one of their own and they are committing or encouraging a sense of conflict of interest in this case from the start, and they don't want to taint the case, and they come up with all these excuses. The fact is, it is their job. That's why they're paid very well. That's why they are an apparatus. And it is funny, when the apparatus has to go after one of its own, in both senses, two white males accused of killing a black man, and law enforcement, one of them having been a law enforcement investigator, they will justify it and say, well, we wanted this case to be free of taint. We did not want this case to have any questions about it, any semblance of impropriety. As again, I say it's hogwash. And if we allow local authorities this escape route, as has been granted them several times, and people are convinced by them that this is for the case's own good, here they are petitioning the feds to come in and save the day. The feds, being a higher authority, would assure justice will be done. No. As Cab Calloway used to sing, it ain't necessarily so. So there ought to be resolute action on this point. It shouldn't just be, of course, we understand the focus of it is the tragedy itself, this killing, and how much time has elapsed with nothing happening in the way of prosecution and thorough investigation. But by God, if taxpayer money is paying for what you call the best of investigative services to the people of the state, let the prosecutors, the state prosecutor, do its job. And let's see, out in the open, let's not pass the buck so quickly. Let's find out why. Let's have them argue in the court why they're yielding this case to the federal government, even though the federal government has not yet even said, yeah, we'll take the case over. You can rest easy now. We've got it. Nope. That's a ruse. We have been through as a community for a very long time. It is intended to communicate, we take this case so seriously, and we want to assure you that any mistrust you have or are likely to have in this process is misplaced. We wouldn't go to this extent to assure justice if we didn't mean it. Let's put that issue to the test and insist that this case, under heavy supervision, be tried where it belongs, right there in the state. Let's see in the open what they intend to do to water down the severity of this case in anticipation of watering down whatever the punishment might be. So whenever you hear about a case being taken over by the federal investigators or federal prosecutors, don't be so quick to believe that, good Lord, the situation is being saved because now the feds are involved and they can't play their usual games, the local people, that is. You'd be surprised. I've seen many cases in which the feds were called in and nothing spectacular occurred at all. We must insist, because that is a way of calling them to account. We cannot let them just exist and as observers. No, they are to be involved. They're the ones who should try this case. And we will see how they intend to try the case when the case is tried locally. The second thing is this. We have recurring themes here in this case. We have the racial divide. Two armed white men chasing down a black man who's unarmed, who was jogging. He was jogging while black. That's the new crime. Deserving death. These guys in their pickup truck running around with shotguns and pistols were in fact serving as the local law enforcement. They took it upon themselves to exercise that authority. Neither of them is affiliated with any law enforcement agency. They're just two white guys. Although one, the father, at one time had worked as an investigator. But even so, he no longer does. But what, under what authority were these two men, these two white men, operating when they chose not only to confront this black man, who was seen regularly jogging through the neighborhood? Under what authority did they have the right to confront him armed? Under what authority were they operating? Are we to understand that part of Georgia? We have the posse comitatus, vigilantes who operate in the open, who shoot down people, who chase down people and kill them as they see fit. Are we to understand that we should not at all construe this to be unusual and wrong and illegal? Are we to understand that any white person, just like in the old days of slavery, you dispatch your patterollers, as they were called at the time, patterollers. That's where the word patrol comes from. They would send out these posses to detect where the patterollers are, because they listen for the patter of their feet as they try to navigate streams and rivers and rough terrain in order to catch them. I'm so sorry, you may be hearing noise in the background. They like me. They love me here. So that when they start trimming trees and hedges, right by my window is where they usually start. But we will make it through. So there are questions that need to be asked here. Is this now standard practice? Are they being given the same status of law enforcement officers who, by their suspicion, went into action with their guns chasing after this man, and upon finding him, shot him to death? It was their theory that he looked a lot like another black man who had been frequenting the neighborhood. There was a report of a few burglaries and illegal entries into people's homes. So I guess this is their local version of the posse comitatus. We have organized ourselves as a militia, and we're operating with that mindset. We have the right even to kill you. And of course, we know we cannot evade the point. It comes down to a question of race. Would they have thought of this young man the same way? Would they have pursued him in the same way had he been white? They didn't know him, but they surmised he looked like somebody that might have broken into people's properties and stolen things. He was just jogging. So I wanted to get at these important elements, the inescapable elements of this case, even as it shapes up. We have local authorities prepared to hand the case and the investigation over to the federal government. In fact, they're petitioning the federal government to come in and handle this case, because they suspect, and they write, it might be a flashpoint for ongoing tensions in the community. And those tensions may be violent. They may be right again. Why would the state authorities allow the transfer of this case to the federal government? People may say, well, the feds have statutes that are far more serious than the statutes under which they might be inclined to prosecute at the state level. That's hogwash. It's murder. It's the unwarranted death of a young man for no reason other than he was black and he was jogging while black. The circumstances don't change because the venue changes. That's the issue. We've had quite a few cases around the country of this disparity in the dispensation of justice. And we see the entire system basically concocting a rationale for removing the case from the direct oversight of the people by saying, or by pretending in saying, that transferring the case to the feds is an indication of how serious this case is and how seriously the feds are taking it. But it is, in fact, in my view, a deliberate effort to avoid taking responsibility for prosecuting cases of this profile. We've seen it time and again. And people hearing the news, if the federal government steps in, oh, great, the federal government is in, and that means they're taking this seriously, and surely we will get a conviction, and the local folks don't have a shot. They don't have a chance now. Don't be so quick to come to that conclusion. I'll take a break and come back to your questions and comments at 888-874-4888 right after this. Sky high. Send that boy off to die. This impression, because that's what he did quite regularly. He would go out jogging, and this was no different than the other times that he went jogging. And turns out the next thing she hears is that he's dead, shot to death by two local vigilante types, father and son. And they cornered him, and moving on him in a very threatening way. In fact, They had guns. And they demanded information of him, or from him, but his whole thing was, what is this? What's happening? And before you know it, he's shot dead. One of the men who accosted him, the father, was a former police investigator. And based on that and other factors, the heat it's generating, for example, in a local community, and it is spreading now across the nation, people are concerned about this case. There was an effort to say, well, it is so important. This case is so important, and we don't want any funny stuff associated with it. We don't want any suspicions that we're not doing the right thing. They've made some kind of an appeal to the federal prosecutors to take over the case. And that's where it is right now. The feds have not indicated that they will, but I'm saying that we shouldn't be so taken in by the rationale that this case is so serious that the feds are coming in. No, times these cases provide the rationale for the feds to come in and cover things up. And I'm saying specifically that if a state apparatus of law enforcement and prosecution is admitting that it suspects it doesn't have the capacity to try a case like this, then the office ought to be disbanded and everybody fired, because it would mean that they have the wrong people. If you can't, as a prosecutor, handle a case that is so straightforward, and you're so afraid to tackle it, then you have no reason to be in that office, and that office has no reason to exist. 888-874-4888. Khalil from South Carolina, you're on the air.
Hi, I hope you're doing well and everyone else on this beautiful spring day.
Thank you.
I have to say, I wholeheartedly agree with your observations and your take on this. It's so much. I think this looks so simple when you look at this, but the implications are just, there's so much here. There's so much meat on this bone. And what you're saying about the federal level of law enforcement, excuse me, that is passé, like 1980s and Reconstruction. That was the last time that the federal government really protected black people, probably to a large extent, in some degree. But weak is a lot here, and I know time is short. But you see, that's the fake out. If they are that incompetent, they are a failed municipality or hamlet, whatever they are. They have failed. Their whole system has failed. Number one, if that's how they want to proceed, but. You know, we have to understand, I live in the South. Let me tell you, when you go to get a concealed carry permit, you look at doctrine, and then it goes, you pass the test, the shooting range, and then it goes to the local sheriff's office where they determine if you have a character. And that's where the black folks get filtered out. And what happens legally, you have more power over a regular citizen when you have a concealed carry permit. All you need to do is say, I felt threatened, and you can shoot someone dead. And that's the law. And it's unfortunate, but that is the law, and they know that. And that's one component. And this federal government, this regime, we have to understand, in my opinion, and I'm going to ask you also, but this is a precipitate of Trumpism. You see, a lot of white people are scared. They know the browning of America is on its way. It's happening. It's done. There's no way to stop it. So they're grasping at every piece of power that they can. Because every attorney general we've had since this regime started has placed a premium on white supremacy. the first thing that Sessions did was Black Lives Matter, a quasi-terroristic group. And they didn't mention anything, even though the data would suggest, you know, the data would suggest that white supremacy and these militia groups are the largest problem, but they totally ignore that. Have you seen these statistics?
No, I haven't seen the statistics.
Well, that's what's frightening about this Justice Department. And if we're paying attention on a bigger scale, this administration doesn't plan to leave lightly. They're putting people in place. This has been a coup, a junta. I mean, this is like Papa Doc Trump. I know it's not about Trump, but it is. These people feel licensed now. You know, and just as you gave your history lesson, you know, we have to remember law enforcement really, the way as we know it, only came about to catch runaway slaves and to keep order. And that's a big part of this. But my God, what is going on? This is absolutely unacceptable. And there's no easy way out of this.
So I'm going to ask you, how are you prepared to react to this development?
Well, number one, I really enjoy your program, and I learn a lot from listening to you. And I'm going to use your advice, and I'm going to just listen for a while and let, quote-unquote, let things come out, such as I heard something 2 days ago that was frightening to me, the smearing of not only the victim, but the family.
Yes.
The smearing of the family has started. So, you know, this is going to be very, very messy in this type of climate. Because, you know, people can act like things are okay all they want, but white supremacy is on the rise. And I'm not trying to be conspiratorial. And, you know, when you get to a certain level, mostly you're the only black person in the room. And you hear things. You see things. And, you know, it's different. You know, that's I always talk about Ralph Ellison because the invisible man.
Invisible man.
We have to understand the greater culture, their culture, but we know what we're about. So it's interesting. But I'm so glad that you brought up the federal side of this, because this is going to be interesting how this plays out.
We have to keep our eyes on it, and. Mm-hmm. You will see how it evolves to an ending that we could predict right now. Even if there is a conviction, you will see all the things that would water down that conviction in the conviction itself. So they give the antidote. Pack the antidote in. Thanks, Khalil, for your call, for starting us off today. Henry from Chicago, you're on the air.
Hey, Treece, how's it going?
Okay, you tell me. How's it going by you?
We're hanging in here. We're hanging it over here. You know, I would probably say refusal of the local Georgia authorities to investigate this is, for me, a simple case of charging two race soldiers for upholding the system of white supremacy. Basically, two white men killing a black man, for them is kind of, you know, legal. So. They don't want to shoulder that responsibility of, you know, charging an actual murder to two white race soldiers for killing a black man. So, you know, but if it was a case of somebody of color, you know, like they did with executing Troy Davis and the Atlanta grading scandal, where majority of the convicted were, you know, people of color, particularly black people, that's no problem. But, you know, they don't want to charge, you know, white men killing black men. I mean, it's reminiscent to me of lynching, during Jim Crow. So basically, you know, I thought of Emmett Till and, you know, how those men got off of, you know, murdering Emmett Till. So, and then also too, now correct me if I'm wrong, but I remember that the feds came in to investigate the Eric Garner case, and it took them, what, 4 years to kind of say, well, there was nothing wrong? I mean, am I correct on that? Because I remember the feds were involved in that case as well, and it took them 4 years to just say the same thing that the New York investigator said. So in that particular case, you know, why are we bringing in the feds? And the only reason why you would bring in the feds in this particular case is if you're going to charge anybody, you should charge that local government, you know, probably put RICO cases on them because of the fact that they've, you know, they have been complicit in a lot of injustices, you know, over the last couple of decades, you know, of locking up and unjustly executing black people in that state. So that's the only thing that I would say bringing the feds for is to, you know, like you said, not just get rid of them, but to actually arrest them.
But it's also to give the veneer, to provide a veneer that real justice is being dispensed. And it is something that the local people should be comforted by and should be very supportive of, that the feds are the corrective measure here. You know, even though the local law enforcement agencies are ready to yield their jurisdiction and say, okay, feds, you got it. We're out. We're bowing out in deference to you and your skill and your power and your ability to pursue justice. It's all a farce. It's a farce.
Yeah.
At least in all the cases I've looked at and have covered myself, we see the same ritual going on. Look very carefully in the very near future. The community will be provided with a dossier. And that dossier will state emphatically why the men who pursued Ahmaud were correct. They may not have been official members of any police force or any law enforcement agency, but their instincts were correct, and they were motivated by the correctness of their instincts. It's coming. It's coming.
Wow. That is crazy. Yep. That is crazy.
They were able to read from a distance, you know, that it's that awful joke in the Western movies where say the judge asks a guy, well, why'd you kill him? Why did you kill this man? And the answer is, Your Honor, he needed killing. That's the answer. He needed killing, so we killed him. That's a version of what I think is happening here.
I hope you're wrong, but I just got a feeling.
Me too. I hope I'm wrong. But it turns out invariably that I am not. Because I see the steps that this is going in, and it's telling. It's telling that they've already had come up with a plan of action. The most important thing is to let people think that this is such a serious matter that the federal government is interceding and the local state government is saying, we can't handle this. This is too much for us. We are not as sophisticated as the feds would be in handling this case. Thanks, Henry. Good to hear from you today.
Thank you.
Ma'at, you're on the next.
Yes. First of all, they need to set up a special unit, and it's happening in certain cities of conviction review, because this the father was both a police officer and an investigator in the DA's office, and they need to look at all his cases, all the people that got convicted under his watch in both roles, and look to probably exonerate a lot of people, get a lot of people out of prison. But this is really something, and we know that the feds have an abysmal record. I mean, even under Democratic presidents, it goes nowhere. And first, the state has to go to a trial and basically not get a conviction, and then or not. And then with the Romali Graham case, where a police officer busted down his door and went to his bathroom and shot him for no reason at all, and the so-called progressive Preet Bharara came up with a press release as to why he wasn't going to bring justice to that situation. So it doesn't look good, and we have to come up with a blueprint to make it better.
Well, we do have the blueprint. The blueprint is our feet. We have to march. We have to get out in the streets. We have to make it an issue.
No, I'm talking about something beyond marching and protesting.
But in the meantime, that's what we're doing. And it's better than nothing. We've got to do something to indicate the righteous anger of the community. And that is very, very important, to keep this on the front burner, to not let them think that, well, you know, they got over with a flimsy explanation, and then we wait and see how it turns out. We can tell you how it turns out now. Statistically, we know how it's going to turn out.
Yeah, they're just trying to affect a sleight of hand.
Well, we have to insist that the sleight of hand does not occur. Thank you so much. That brings us to the end of our program today. Let's meet again tomorrow and talk some more. Thanks for listening. Set back.